I am trained as an architect, but became a landscape architect later and have been involved and engaged in the relationship between the built environment and the natural environment and all the interactions in between. And my first job was at the Nature Conservation Department of a ministry in The Hague as a planner. And there I got all kinds of works that, well, you could say were the large hydraulic and coastal defense works of the Netherlands. And to try to engage with that from the standpoint of nature conservation. And in that time, a great discovery was made in the Netherlands, well, metaphorically. It was the Oostvaardersplassen. And the Oostvaardersplassen were to be an industrial estate in the Flevo Polder. Well, they didn't pump it dry because they needed it only 40 years later. And what happened there was spectacular. Nature came in as a sort of squatter movement. All kinds of birds that haven't been seen since the mid-19th century came back there. So we saw a flourishing nature development there. And the next step of that was, of course, that you could also make nature instrumental and try to reach, let's say, human goals with natural means and try to make nature technique into the civil engineering for the advanced. And that was our ambition to do so. So I've always been extremely interested in the relation between, let's say, the human planning and the answers nature gives to that, and to reverse that, to use the answers of nature to get your things done. Well, let me say this first, because what is always a sort of barrier to the implementation of nature-based solutions is that they always cost more land than, let's say, technical solutions. And these nature-based solutions only, let's say, get implemented when you are, well, looking into the other, let's say, benefits they can produce. And so a green-blue infrastructure is not only a green-blue infrastructure as such, but it also brings relief in urban heat island situations. It doesn't use fossil fuel. It adds biodiversity. So all these, let's say, imponderable, not to be made explicit in money, kind of benefits have to be sort of if you think in military terms, these are your allies, and with all these allies, you have to win the battle. I think landscape architecture, but in a lesser way, also urbanism, is always about a spatial and a temporal aspect and the interaction in between them. And as urbanists, as landscape architects, we sort of tend to be focused too much on the spatial side and turn a blind eye to all the processes that are that are active at the same time, and sometimes are even formative for what you see in space. So the temporal dimension is extremely important. There is one example that I would say springs to mind. I have been active together with the colleagues of civil engineering at the TU Delft on a project called the Sand Engine. And well, you have to understand that the Netherlands is protected by a dune coast, a natural dune coast, and there with every storm, a lot of sand of that dune coast is eroded. And so our coastal defense depends on beach nourishment, and that is being done by a complete fleet of dredging ships. And we, well, played with the idea to position a large dune off the coast and let it be eroded by the tidal current around the coast. That is 3 steps forward, 2 steps back, because each time the North Sea basin is filled and empty itself at low tide, this tidal river comes along the coast. And what we thought that could be possible if we try to position that dune in exactly a strategic place, this tidal stream eroding the huge dune could bring the sand to the weak spots of the coast. And it sounds like an idiotic idea, because, well, you are going to lose the sand back to the sea, but modeling of Marcel Steven of the TU Delft showed that only 10% of the sand is lost in that way, and the other 90% can be really redistributed. And now, why I bring up this example when it comes to the temporal aspect, it was decided to make a large, or rather large, pilot of this idea. 22 million cubic meter dune was installed off the coast of South Holland. And what you see there, and what you will see there, is that time is a sort of ally, because what you see is that this artificial sand engine is going to be inhabited by plants, by animals, etc., etc. And this pioneers sort of stabilize the sand engine. And when you are looking into the future, because we have of course references of that in our natural coast, you see that the vegetation succession will stabilize the land behind the sand engine even more, and as a bonus will bring you a very attractive sort of nature area. So you see that coastal defense with natural means have as a bonus a very spectacular vegetation development.